More often, we have done a survey of each one. We've taught the introduction, the text, and then the major points. Contrary to what some may have been pitched as the presentation, to study them well, we've only given a survey. We could go back in and spend a whole year on each of those epistles and still not exhaust the wisdom that's found within. So just wanted you to know that. Also, studying these epistles, how Jesus is portrayed, how the truth of Christ is seen, all the way down, we've gone through this list, and John has highlighted in 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John, we see that Jesus is our blessed assurance. He is our salvation. He is the one through our obedient faith in Him, our confidence resides. And that is good. I think that we do a disservice to the church and to every Christian and to ourselves if we do not focus on 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John. Instead of typing a lot of things that I was going to share with you, I instead decided to employ a technique and a method that I had to acquire about a month ago when one of my laptop, actually, the screen went out. It was a hardware issue. The screen went out. I had to plug up my computer to my TV, do some work from the home, and then use three other computers with different programs to get it done. I missed my files. I'm glad to have them back. But I decided, you know, instead of typing, and I don't like to type, ironically, because I do a lot of it, I just decided to show you resources and how I glean things from them that make all the difference. But from about four or five different resources I gathered from what others have studied regarding for 2nd and 3rd John. In this case, I did not provide an outline for you, so I hope you have your Bibles, and we will soon get to the very brief text of 2nd and 3rd John. It only takes 2 or 3 minutes to read each one. But we will teach as we go, and I'm supposed to teach the text. There's a lot of overlapping points of introduction that Ron mentioned that are necessary for understanding the text that I will mention again. But here is a lot of text on the screen that you might be able to read more clearly on your phone. You can screenshot anything you see later. But I will read some things that I like to study and prepare from resources I appreciate. And this one says, taken together, that means all three epistles of John, stand poised as a demonstration of the critical importance of testing all attempts to re-articulate the gospel by the immutables of the gospel revelation. In other words, someone coming in trying to change the gospel, you put it to the test and use truth to defend, decimate it. Doubtless, John's opponents saw themselves as being on the leading edge of the Christian revelation or reflection, 2 John 9. By contrast, John reverts to what was from the beginning, to the testimony of the first eyewitnesses, to the incontrovertible Christological givens. In other words, okay, you're trying to change, you're trying to come along after the fact and say, let me tell you what Jesus was really like when you weren't even there. John says, I was there, and it's not going to happen. Let me tell you how it is. He says, to the perennial newness of the old covenant, of the old command to love one another, to the irrevocable connection between genuine faith and obedience, this collectively lets us see so much about Christianity in practice. This stance has a bearing on what teachings a church will listen to as we focus on 1 John. There are some things we just don't listen to, and some things you never see. They're pre-filtered in the sense that we protect you for sure, and some things in your own world you have to do the same. But there have been some people over my tenure here who've come through and wanted to teach certain things, and they don't even see the light of day. Some things just aren't going to happen. At the practical level, whether heresy stands between or behind 3 John or not, and that's a question, what motivated the writing, it's the holistic vision that insists that there is no place for petty gurus in the church who will not bow to apostolic admonition and authority. It's usually those who don't want to listen to the authority that ignore the 3rd John letter, and that's typical of the very nature. The Johannine epistles, those three that he wrote, make an important contribution to the doctrine of assurance, 1 John 5:13. Assurance. I don't want to live my life without knowing that my confidence is in Christ. If other New Testament writings make it clear that the objective grounds for our confidence before God are in Christ and His death and resurrection on our behalf, such that Christian assurance is not more than a, and here it is, commandant of genuine faith, I'll reword all this later. These epistles insist that a distinction must be made between genuine faith and spurious faith. That is, I'm professing to be a Christian, but I'm really not living it out. John, 1st, 2nd, 3rd John makes it clear you're not genuinely believing if you're not genuinely living. There's no way to get around that. And John is so good. And I love those absolutes. Probably why I love to study these epistles so much. Spurious faith does not have the right to assurance before God. Ouch. Wow. Powerful. Can't deny it. I have to say that's true. That's a horrible truth. Genuine faith can be authenticated not only by the validity of its object, in this case, Christ being the Son of God, but also the transformation it affects in the individual. I love the way academia words itself so that no one can misunderstand. But once you understand, then you get it. It's like, wow, this is incredible. Yes, the transformation in our life. How can we teach Christ and not share as well the accompanying effect of what it means to know Him? Our life is changed. If there is no change, there is no difference. There is no belief in who He really is. There's no knowledge of Him. Awareness is a word I heard last week. Christian assurance is not, that is for John, Christian assurance is not an abstract good. It is intimately tied to a continuing and transforming relationship with the covenant God who has revealed Himself in Jesus Christ. Whew! Is that your understanding of Christ? Oh, if it's not, I hope it becomes that way. But I think over the time it has, maybe even more so, been refined to see it this way. And the last portion says, though their treatment of certain subjects is distinctive, here there is measured but emphatic emphasis on eternal life. When I think of eternal life, I think about the writings of John through the inspiration of the Spirit. John is who I go to. With the Father that has been mediated by the Son, on the Son's atonement, and on the Holy Spirit. Wow. So, since we're about to look at the last epistle, or I should say the last inspired epistle of John, Revelation's in a different category. Let's look at a thumbnail of his life. In Acts chapter 14, chapter 8, verse 14, John is associated with the apostles who were at Jerusalem, and Paul calls him one of the pillars of the Jerusalem church. Apart from Revelation 1, the New Testament is silent about his later years, but early Christian tradition uniformly tells us that he left Jerusalem probably soon before AD 70 and its destruction there, that he ministered in and around Ephesus. That was the place, the headquarters, so to speak, for his ministry. The seven congregations in the area, the seven churches in the Roman province of Asia, mentioned in Revelation 2 and 3, were probably part of his ministry, most likely. John's effective testimony for Christ led the Roman authorities to exile him to the small, desolate island of Patmos in the Aegean Sea. And the date of his release is unknown, but he was probably, and here's something to know, probably allowed to return to Ephesus after the reign of Domitian. And this is where we will look at the map. The chronology of when he returned and wrote those letters versus the revelation, of course, on Patmos. It is good to know that he stayed in Ephesus quite a while. So, just some areas geographically to see where key events took place. We're going to first look at that area of Jerusalem, bottom right square. John and his brother James apparently met Jesus through preaching of John the Baptizer. And isn't it interesting to think about? They were there from the beginning and at the moment, not really aware of what all was happening, the significance of it all. Don't you know they reflected on this and thought, with all that I now know and all that was happening before my coming to awareness, I was there and able to experience or witness some of these things from the beginning of his ministry. Wow, incredible to be able to say that. And then, of course, up at number two, way up there at the beginning of the Jordan, we have he let his fishing nets down and started following Jesus. That's what they did back then. They wanted to follow people and be students of people who they thought were going somewhere and to learn. And there was something different about Jesus indeed. And then it says here that he and his brother James were called sons of thunder at that time. Isn't this interesting? I often think about how he was and how Christ changes your life. He wrote so much about how Christ changes your life because his life was changed. We do a disservice to Peter and we are fair to John. Whatever I mean. John was a son of thunder, the nature of rage and anger and wrath. John was that way in his earlier days when Jesus called him, right? And yet he became the apostle of love. We're not fair to Peter. We focus so much on the accounts during his young days and his impetuous nature that we forget how he became. And went recently studying 1st and 2nd Peter, maybe we appreciate Peter more than we did before. So let's be fair to both. When you come to Christ, your life is going to begin to be changed. And that's exactly what happened to both. We have, let's see, what's another one here? Number three, center block. Traveled with Jesus during his public ministry. Heard the teachings. He saw the miracles and witnessed the transfiguration. Witnessing any of those, hearing his teachings, seeing the miracles and the transfiguration where the metamorphosis of the divine showed through the flesh. It's incredible to think about this. Now, I think about 1 John 1:13, and I can't help but think that because of that experience, he wrote a lot about light. Well, he literally saw the light of truth. Number four, he remained in... back down a little bit in Jerusalem. He remained with Jesus during his final week of his life. Triumphant entry, the rejection, the Last Supper, the Gethsemane trial, and the crucifixion itself. Also, he worked with Simon Peter as a leader of the early church. And we're not... It's just an incidental, perhaps, that we don't hear from him much after that, the death of his brother James. But it is what it is. Very interesting. But we know he was faithful all along. And then let's move all the way up to that little island of Patmos, you know, with all the places that Matt is visiting, and I want to see every one of them myself. I think about where would I choose to pick first if I had to pick. That's a tough choice. But within the top three considerations would be that island right there, because the revelation of Jesus Christ given to John is my favorite New Testament contribution. I cannot imagine New Testament without the revelation. It's so sad that false doctrines have been covered all over it. When you brush those away, it is a beautiful, beautiful, encouraging book, and we will focus on that next year. But that's the island where God gave John what we need to hear today. It's going to be okay. The message is going to be okay. I'm coming back for my people, and I know who you are. Wow. Great stuff. And then, of course, after his release, tradition holds that he spent much time in Ephesus to wrap it up, and wrote the gospel. And not holding back from chronology, at least in Ephesus, he wrote the gospel and the epistles. And we're hoping that he did come back to Ephesus. There is also a little point of tradition that says that he was quickly jumping onto a horse in his later years in order to make haste to go preach the gospel somewhere. There is an eyewitness testimony in tradition, anyway, that says he saw John quickly get up on a horse and ride off to go preach the gospel. And that's the spirit that I feel that all the apostles had, for that matter. So good to know these things. 2nd and 3rd John, let's introduce both of them and compare and contrast. Here is, in the textual sense now, a little snippet that I found was interesting to read. Though among the briefest in Scripture, these two one-chapter books, are of continuing relevance to the church, these reflect similar circumstances and have similar contents. In each book, the author warns of the divisiveness of false or self-serving teachers. Now, there's something about the ministry that can attract people who want the attention. If that's the case, watch out. But the divisiveness that comes from either false or self-serving teachers is to be avoided and cut off at all costs. And he offers, on the other side, encouragement to genuine believers. 2 John cautions its readers about receiving heretics into the homes or churches, while 3 John encourages the proper fellowship among Christian brothers. And we will note the stern difference in due time, Lord willing. True believers not only walk in truth, but they walk in love. And we know how important fellowship is. And frankly, the more we study hospitality, what it is in Scripture, the more we can see the sternness of this command to not offer hospitality to those who are not in truth. We want unity. We want the fellowship with people. But that can't happen if they're not in Christ. Not to the level of understanding. We share that in common. And that's where the blessings of Christ reside and are limited to, quite frankly. People on the outside of the Christ need to see that and come to the Lord because of it. So based on 2 John 9 through 11 and 3 John 9 through 11, We are rooted in Christ, and the extension of fellowship and hospitality is limited to those who abide in the teachings of Christ. Just yesterday, I came across a Winkler devotional that I was reminded of, and he mentions the importance of abiding in truth, which is the proper response to truth. That's the benefit of truth, and that's the proper response to truth. That's what it brings. He says, "I have written to you, young men, because the word of God abides in you," 1 John 2:4. And then he says, "I'm challenging you, Christians, let that abide in you, which you've heard from the beginning." So abiding, like Ron mentioned, deals with daily walking. Daily walking, humble obedience, love for others, defense of truth, and our prayer life. As we're walking in Christ, as we're abiding in Christ, there's a sense in which we are following after Christ and that he's my leader. There is another sense in which we are beside Jesus and that he's with us. And there's a sense as a disciple we are following after Jesus in that we are mimicking his moves. So we are truly learning to be like Christ. And that's what it means. That's in John's mind when he writes just such few words and verses. What does it say? Truth be told. It is interesting to compare these two. Both deal with the treatment of itinerant teachers. 2 John was written to instruct readers to not receive those who deny the incarnate word of God. 3 John was written to instruct believers to receive those with a history of loving the truth and walking in it. The date, often placed around 90 or so, written in Ephesus. 2 John is addressed to an elect lady. Ron mentioned the options, and I will speak as though I am sharing my conclusion, what I believe is most rational, based on the idea and style and writing. And that will come through as I'm focusing on the figurative description of the local church. 3 John was occasioned by the reports of an Asian church that had a man in it named Diotrephes, had seized control and power, rejected teachers sent out by John, and was expelling those in his church. I find it interesting that he describes that he thought it was his church. Now, first of all, it may have become that because there's no one there following Christ at that point, but it's not his church. It's not our church. It's no one's church except Christ's. We give him the honor. Here is how 2 John looks if you outline it in a chart form. And doing this, of course, helps me stay focused on what key points are there and not to get lost in the details. And I love charts like these. Essentially, in the highlighted reds, you see that abiding in God's commands is the opposite from abiding with false teachers. And abiding means walking. What does it mean to abide in God's commandments? It means you walk in them. You live them out. You don't just continue to agree with them. You are living them. And walking in this way means truth. And walking in truth means walking in love. He emphasizes that. So it's one and the same. Abide in truth and love. And that's easy to remember. When it comes to the green on the bottom there, if you focus on this text as a topic, you have to focus on then the practice of truth, and therefore you are protecting it as well. You can't practice it and not eventually run into those moments where you are protecting it. You will come and encounter with people who oppose it, and you have to defend it and stand strong no matter what in your own resolve. Themes and literary structure, three lines down. John encourages the readers to continue walking in love, but exhorts them to be discerning in their expression of love. Ron mentioned, you know, the phrase that some people say today, "Don't judge me." You ever hear that? You know, they don't want a standard applied to them, so they don't want the standard applied to them, and therefore they don't want to be judged by what will. The world will be judged by the world. But we have to discern what we want to live by and say that if we believe the Bible, and we do, then here is how it describes your situation or this condition or that false teaching. John encourages us to walk in love, but be discerning in the expression of it. The book may be divided into two parts, and we showed it earlier. Abide in God's commandments, and abide not in false teaching. So now let's get to the text. The reading of it, that is. Text time. Verse 1. 2 John, verse 1. The elder. All right. John describes himself in one word to show authority. Yes, he is older. Yes, but this is the Apostle John we're talking about. He could talk to an elder who's been an elder in the church for 30 years, 60 years, and still say, "My little child." My little children. If the Apostle John says that, he can get away with it, right? This is an inspired apostle we're talking about. And so it was important for him to distinguish himself this way right from the beginning. To the elect lady, this is a sound, sanctified congregation by my interpretation. It makes most sense to me. To the elect lady, a sound, sanctified congregation, and to her children, each member, whom I love in truth, and not only I, but also all those who have known the truth, because of the truth which abides in us and will be with us forever. The truth unifies us. We are united in the truth, okay? Let me mention a commentary note. This truth is that Christ is both God and man is more than a set of prepositions. It is living and it abides forever. Wow. So this one verse, if you look carefully or don't read it too quickly, it's linking up who he is to what he teaches. What he teaches is who he is. He is the way, the truth, and the life. He is truth. He is life. Jesus is the truth. Jesus is the life. So it's linking them up together. You can't say, I know Jesus and ignore his teachings. That doesn't happen. You don't know him that way. And we need to know the truth who gives life. Interesting how he sneaks that in there. Doesn't sneak it in there, but it's there so potently. Verse 3. Grace, mercy, and peace be with you from God the Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of the Father, in truth and love. He's focusing on intentionally on the connection from the Son, Jesus incarnate, and the Father. Because of the opposition that is being faced. And anyone who would hear this letter would make it obvious. It would be obvious in the day, that is. Verse 4. I rejoice greatly that I have found some of your children walking in truth, as we have received commandment from the Father. So it's authentic. They're following in the proper pattern. And now I plead with you, lady. This is an endearing term, by the way, of showing dignity to the individual. It's a respectful begging. Not as though I wrote a new commandment to you. You're hearing a bunch of new stuff. It's not like that. But that which we have heard from the beginning. There's that phrase, so similar to his style. That we love one another. Love one another. There's the distinctive term to look for. These other people, not talking about Christ, trying to lead people away from Christ, they don't know him enough to practice the proper love. And so that's how one way you can distinguish the Lord's people. All right, this love that we walk according to his commandments. Ron emphasized this. Is this how people define love today? Are you living by the commandments of God? That is, scripturally speaking, what love is and how you know it. Can't you just imagine John thinking of what he's already written, most likely, in John 15:14 and John 13:35. He wrote about how you are my friends. I mean, yes, you're following me, but get this, I have elevated you to the status of friend because I have let you be aware of my Father's business. Following Jesus is his, it makes us his friend. John 13:35, here's how the world's going to know that you love me: if you keep my commandments. Follow me, keep my commandments. That's the idea. That's in John's mind, and we see it in one little verse. This is love, that we walk according to his commandments. Beautiful. Wow. And then it says, this is the commandment that you have heard from the beginning. You should walk in it. Walk in it. There's that walk. There's that abiding again. And I'd like to read this commentator note. Genuine love for God is shown through obedience. Indeed it is. Indeed it is. Now, let's shift gears here. Verse 7 and following. Abide not with false teachers. Okay. For many deceivers have gone out into the world. Okay. This is present tense. They have today, right now, gone out. John is writing this. How long ago? 2,000 years? They do not confess that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh. That's the key mark. They deny the divinity and the humanity of Christ. They deny Christ. That's the standard. And we need to protect ourselves from this. How? This is a deceiver and an antichrist. Now I'm going to go to some notes that I taught many years ago, and I'm just going to read some things. If you want to make a reference, I'm in 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2, verses 18 and following. The second half of verse 18, he says, and you have heard that the antichrist is coming. Even now, they're here. They're here. Okay, John continues to write, and of course I know that people have always loved to talk about, you know, some key figures that are of the day that may represent, you know, key apocalyptic terms taken out of context, usually from Daniel or Revelation. We'll get to all that next year. It'll be fun. But a lot of times they forget that the last days, according to Scripture, are the days that we are currently in the reign of Christ. And they confuse the two. So they look ahead when it's really present tense so often. One of my points from years ago said, John actually indicated the term Antichrist can refer to anyone who opposes the work of God, because he says that term in the plural sense. Even now, antichrists have come. And sometimes I've often wondered how people get around this. They can read the text and then still hold to a false idea that's been interpolated upon it. How? Why? It's because, well, one wording was this. I said, well, it's just describing the spirit that was already at work in some that will be in the one later. But that's adding to the text. John was, I'm going to read this to you. John was talking about the spirit of evil at work in the world in every age and in every generation who takes a stand contrary to the spirit of God. Antichrist, quote unquote, is simply a synonym for Satan and his many manifestations in human life. What does that mean in the academic sense translated? It means a lot of people believe the devilish idea, the false doctrine, that Jesus is not the Christ. And verses 22 and 23 of 1 John 2, 1 John 2, 22 and following. Who is he? This is the same writer, by the way. Are we going to let the same one who God inspired to write the Revelation tell us who the Antichrist is? Are we going to allow that? I don't want to burst people's bubble, but the truth has to do that sometimes. Who is, verse 22, who is a liar but he who denies that Jesus is the Christ? He is Antichrist, who denies the Father and the Son. Whoever denies the Son does not have the Father either. He who acknowledges the Son has the Father also. Well, that makes it simple. And it saves me a lot of frustration trying to figure out things that the world just gets lost in. And they get so lost in figuring things out, but they're not living according to the life of those simple, short epistles that we looked at earlier. Amazing, incredible what people get wrapped up in and kind of trapped by, ensnared by. To conclude on this one, I would say, according to John, those who deny Jesus is the Christ do not know the Father. Therefore, they are the Antichrists. So if anyone asks you who the Antichrist is, you can explain to them it's anyone who denies Jesus is Lord. Going back to the text. Actually, I'm going to put a pause on this. Let's look at verse 8. Look to yourselves, which means make sure you use truth to defend your soul. Your soul, your feelings, your thoughts, that's not the standard. You're to use the standard to protect yourself against these false doctrines. Look to yourselves that we do not lose the things that we worked for, but that we may receive a full reward. Wow. One commentator's note said, the key to opposing false doctrine is for God's people to abide in the doctrine of Christ. Absolutely. Absolutely. The truth, that's how we test the spirits. He wrote about that earlier. The truth that Jesus was fully divine and human, all who teach something different should not be welcomed in a Christian's home or church. In fact, they should be shunned. The church should be a place of grace, but it must never tolerate the undermining of faith. Here is a list that I shared during the 2 Peter class. And it's a little bit more clear than it was the first time. This one right here. Go to your phones and screenshot this portion of time and just see how, remember, John and Peter worked a lot together. John would agree with each of these as well. That's what a false teacher does and is. A false teacher, I'll quickly mention them by point, not by reference. They infiltrate the church, false teachers do. They come in secret. They deny the work of Jesus. They blaspheme the truth. They are greedy. They use words remarkably close to truth. They follow the flesh. They are presumptuous and self-willed. They do not want to be under anyone's authority. Hello, Diotrephes. We'll get to you in a minute. God will deal with you for sure. They exhibit peace on the outside, but are like untamed beasts on the inside. They speak more evil than good. They are ignorant. They love to deceive others. They are full of adultery in the way that they live. They cannot cease from sinning. That's their life that they're given to by will. They prey on unstable new believers. They intentionally speak lies. They are out for monetary gain. They talk a lot but say nothing. Oh boy, I don't like cotton candy fluff in sermons. I don't waste my time. And let's see, point 20. They are making grandiose promises but never deliver. They use alluring thoughts to provoke attention from their audience. All they want is the attention. And it's obvious when a person just wants attention. They make promises that they cannot deliver. So back to the text, verse 9. Whoever transgresses and does not abide in the doctrine of Christ does not have God. He who abides, that doesn't sound very loving, by the way, according to today's standards, that doesn't know God. Go figure. He who abides in the doctrine of Christ has both God, the Father, and the Son. Now, he's intentionally not ignoring. It's not that he's ignoring the Holy Spirit. He's focusing on what these writers need to hear in terms of Jesus being God. He doesn't want to confuse the issue just yet. If anyone comes to you and does not bring this doctrine, do not receive him into your house nor greet him. Okay. Now, this is powerful, and I know that in the Old Testament studies we will see this more. Some of you already know this. Hospitality, when you see a stranger walking by, giving yourself, showing love, we don't practice that culturally. We think hospitality is just being nice to your friends once in a while, whatever, or a stranger. Okay. Well, not being hospitable is a sin. It is a deadly sin. Not being hospitable. And that is so ingrained within the Hebrew and Jewish and Christian mind early on that makes the sternness of this command so powerful. This is the exception to not showing hospitality. False teachers. So let's just suppose that someone calls us up and represents some group somewhere. Hello, we're having a convention in Rome, Georgia, and hello, Oak Hill Church of Christ. We're having a convention, and I'd like to let you know what it's about. We're basically letting people know that we don't believe that Jesus is the God or the Bible is His Word, but we were wondering, would you pay our hotel bill? Not going to happen. Not going to happen. Look at verse 12. Having many things to write to you, for he who greets him shares in his evil deeds. I almost forgot verse 11. For he who shares or greets with him shares in his evil deeds. And that's the context. Not to be taken out of context, but to be principally applied. Having many things to write to you, I did not wish to do so with paper and ink, but I do look forward to coming to you, speak to face to face, that our joy may be full. I like that phrase in the context here, that our joy may be full. So to have the greater blessing, I want to be with you for the greater blessing. That is a message for those who have used online services as a crux, and not to have the full benefit of the fellowship with the saints. That is something important, to be together. The Christians, the children of your elect sister, in other words, many members of this congregation, greet you. All right, 2 John in conclusions. Briefly so. Okay, this is love. This is love. Discernment, love, and hospitality. Discernment, second line over. Believers needed the ability to separate truth from error, and we need that today. Love, according to John, no one can claim to love God through Christ or His church and then not walk faithfully to truth. Hospitality, Christians' duty and joy, as well as the act of love. This is it, hospitality. It has boundaries, however. God's people must not welcome or accept or associate with or support anything or anyone who undermines the truth of the gospel. What does this mean for you? Also, love with discernment. Four lines down. I want you to note that John wants to remind the church to be cautious. Bottom two lines. Every believer is responsible for lovingly guarding and carefully upholding God's eternal word. His truth is that precious to do. I found that those who care more about truth are those who are living it out. And those who are living it out care more about truth. Those who are not living it out will tend to sacrifice those pillars of truth. And that's a sign of not walking and abiding in Christ. Interesting. Well, we have just a few moments to quickly go over 3 John. He commends Gaius's hospitality. He condemns the rebellion of Diotrephes. And that's practically 3 John in a nutshell. Okay, I was wanting to read some of this great stuff, and I'm assessing time. Okay, point two. He's writing to rebuke Diotrephes, a self-assertive leader in the church, for his lack of hospitality toward the brothers, for his dictatorial ways, and for his opposition to apostolic authority of John. He's just denying Jesus altogether. Diotrephes has expelled from the church those who dared to give favor to those who are traveling preachers, those traveling evangelists. Verse 10 contains a threat of a personal visit by John for a direct confrontation with Diotrephes if necessary. I'm thinking, whoa, can you imagine? Now, I don't want to, with any comparison, I don't want to minimize the power and potency of the scripture, but I am a Star Wars fan, and you know that I have very limited science fiction interests, but that's one of them. To me, I'm thinking, John is like Obi-Wan with the blue lightsaber in episode 3, and he's going to face Anakin after he's turned to the dark side and will say, while lovingly so all the time, I'll do what I must. Can you just imagine John going to tell Diotrephes how it's supposed to be? Whew! I would have loved to have been there for that. Third John. This last living apostle was a tiger for truth. In his gospel and three epistles, he mentions it 46 times. He also declares that the test for discerning who is in Christ is to see if they're walking in truth. Here is how the chart looks for the teaching of the text. And I want to focus on, let's see. Gaius is commended, yes, godliness and generosity. Notice how godliness and generosity under the theme of hospitality is used interchangeably. It's a symbiotic relationship. Hospitality is our duty. And if we don't, it could be signs of being haughty. The text, 3 John stresses the theme of enjoying and continuing to have fellowship. And I love fellowship. We are fellow workers. We're fellow soldiers. We're fellow heirs. We share so much if we're in Christ. And that's important. Let's briefly read the text. The elder to the beloved Gaius, whom I love in truth. Beloved, I pray that you may prosper in all things and be in health just as your sons prosper, or your souls prosper. For I rejoiced greatly when brethren came and testified of the truth that is in you, just as you walk in the truth. I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in truth. The Apostle John, we would say today, my spiritual siblings, my brethren, are walking in truth. When I hear about good things happening at congregations that I've been at and with members that I haven't seen in a long time, it cheers me up too. Verse 5, Beloved, you do faithfully whatever you do for the brethren and for the strangers who have borne witness of your love before the church. If you send them forward on their journey in a manner worthy of God, you will do well, because they went forth for his name's sake, taking nothing from the Gentiles. And in the context, I'll briefly say, fully supported by the brethren. Isn't that beautiful? Beautiful. Good job, hat tip and honor to the brethren. We therefore ought to receive such that we may become fellow workers of the truth. Verse 9, I wrote to the church, but Diotrephes, who loves to have the preeminence among them, does not receive us. Therefore, if I come, I will call to mind his deeds, which he does, prating or speaking falsehoods against us with malicious words. And not content with that, he himself does not receive the brethren and forbids those who wish to, putting them out of the church. That's the one that gets me more than anything else. There's a mention briefly about Diotrephes. I have time for this. It's too important not to read. All right, I'll take a liberty on this final class of the series for me. Diotrephes is listed in this Winkler book on devotionals. He lists a lot of things wrong, but he rejects the apostolic authority. He strives for preeminence. He refuses to receive fellow Christian brethren, and expelling good brethren from the fellowship and verbally attacking faithful brethren. Yeah. Well. Beloved, verse 11, beloved, do not imitate what is evil, but what is good. You know, you've heard that phrase, and now you know the context in which it's found. Don't be like that. He who does good is of God, but he who does evil has not seen God. There's that phrase, has not seen God. Demetrius has a good testimony from all and from the truth itself, and we also bear witness, and you know that our testimony is true. I had many things to write to you, but I do not wish to write to you with pen and paper or ink, but I hope to see you shortly, and we shall speak face to face. Peace to you. Our friends greet you. Greet the friends by name. Indeed, we will. For your benefit later, you can screenshot some of these application points. We've talked about walking in truth, being steadfast, showing hospitality, and the sense of family that we have. And all of it is predicated on being selfless, absolutely selfless in your serving of the Lord, which was not like Diotrephes. In conclusion, hey, this is it. I'm going to relish this moment. In 2nd and 3rd John, we are just encouraged to remain a faithful, remain a humble, and remain a hospitable, selfless servant of Christ. This has been a fun series. I thoroughly enjoyed focusing on the text and application thereof. And next week, 2nd and 3rd John, and Jude is so small that Lucian will do a one-stop shop on just that one epistle. And then, oh yeah, I told you I love templates. One more click. The classes and series for me is officially over. I've enjoyed it so much. Thank you for your attention. Looking forward to what's up ahead.